Push it, click it, press it, click it, tune it in, turn it on. This is what you watch it on.
On March 8, 2009, the final Circuit City store closed up shop, citing the end for the retailer. Circuit City, founded in 1949, sold all things electronics. It grew to become America's second largest retailer of its kind, truly hitting its peak in the 80s. However, time would wither away at the retail giant and would eventually become the largest liquidation in US history. So, what's the story behind Circuit City, and what led to its fall? That's what we'll be diving into on tonight's episode of The Story Of. Circuit City's story is really quite bizarre. It starts out in Richmond, Virginia, in 1949. A man named Samuel Wurzel, the owner behind a New York-based import-export business, was on vacation when he decided to go get a haircut. At the barber shop, he took word that the first commercial station would begin broadcasting on televisions in town. This sparked an idea in his head to start a television business in Richmond. And so that he did. In the following period of months, Wurzel would move his family to Richmond and start a store called, get this, Ward's. The name actually has zero connection to the one used in Montgomery Ward. This Ward's was actually an acronym of his family members' names. He also started the store alongside his business partner, Abraham Hecht. Of course, the store started as a television retail store, however, it would eventually diversify shortly down the road, selling other kinds of appliances. It was very successful. A decade after its founding, Ward's had 4 stores, becoming a chain retailer. Wurzel was making around $1 million a year. By this point, Ward's was sort of its own chain. However, in 1960, this would change as the company began to run licensed TV departments in other, larger mass retailers across the US. A year later, Ward's Co. would sell shares on the public stock exchange. A year after this, in 1962, Ward's Co. would start a customer service plan that would give the customers a free TV loan if their TV set couldn't be repaired from home. This, of course, gave them a massive edge over their competitors, as this made the customers more assured when it came to buying from their store. In 1964, Ward's Co. would open another store. This was rapid expansion for the family-owned TV store opened in the 50s. They decided to take an ambitious leap forwards after this. In 1965, the company would purchase the Richmond Carousel Corporation, a Richmond-based department store chain. This buy heavily diversified Ward's inventory. Now, they were selling car supplies, gas, household goods, clothing, toys, and much more. Later that same year, they would go on to also purchase Mermic Inc., a hardware sales company for department stores in Southeast America. It was looking really good for Ward's. In fact, only a year later, the Ward's Co. would open its 6th store in the Walnut Mall Shopping Center. Each store was not massive, some 5 to 8,000 square feet each, but they were making total sales of up to $23 million a year. In 1969, Ward's Co. purchased an audio store called Custom Electronics Inc., growing Ward's overreach by massive amounts, and branching it into different business models, departments, and regions. Ward's now the opportunity to truly maximize their expansion. Not even half a year later, the company bought the TV and appliance company Virginia Beach, giving them 3 new stores. Another store was also opened in Richmond. Only a month after this, Ward's Co. would purchase a store in Indianapolis called The Mart. This store sold appliances, TVs, furniture, and tires, making it a good fit for Ward's Co. Ward's actually stepped all the way into Los Angeles when they operated a television department in Zodi's department stores. Zodi's was a very modern style department chain that shut down in the late 80s. I'll make a video on it at some point. The aggressive expansion kept going, and in 1970, Ward's would purchase Woodville Appliances Inc., giving them 5 new stores in Toledo, Ohio. In the same region, they purchased a home appliances store called the Frank Dry Goods Store in Indiana. Ward's was shockingly massive by this point. It was doing so well, founder Samuel Wurzel would step down from the company along with Hecht, but he stayed on the board. His son Alan Wurzel would become the next company president. Wurzel's first big move as company president would be to open up 2 audio equipment centered stores in Richmond called Sign and Sound. Around this time, audio was becoming a big need in shopping and development. He also began to focus on maximizing company profits, which include closing stores from Fort Wayne, Certified, and a few of their original stores. Following this, the company would begin to expand yet again. 5 new audio-focused stores were opened in the East Coast, DC, and multiple locations in Virginia. Wards would subsequently stop selling tires as a means of, yet again, trying to maximize profits. They also removed their licensed sections in most stores, with the exception of the Zodi's markets. So by now, you might be wondering, isn't this a Circuit City video? Well, this is where the transition from Wards Co. to Circuit City truly begins. Wards Co.'s new leadership decided to go all in on a bold move around that time when they decided to open a new headquarters building on 2040 Thalbro Street, a street named after the Thalheimer Bros. Department store. In the extra space of this building, they opened their first electronics superstore, putting in half the company's net worth. This was a response to the shift in consumer interest to electronic goods around that time. At first, this new store chain was named the Wards Loading Dock. The first store of its kind was a massive 40,000 square foot large warehouse store. Over 2,000 products from home appliances to consumer electronics were on display. Wards saw immediate success with this new store. For one, they already had a head start over their competitors as they had entered the market from early on, at the beginning of the growing interest in electronics. Secondly, because Wards was so financially well off as a company, they could offer way better prices compared to their competition. The loading dock was paying off. Alongside the loading dock, Wards was working on the audio store line they had started beforehand. They began to get rid of their more unrelated chains to focus their corporate vision on the newer, more successful ones. In the 1970s, these stores were transformed into more technologically focused stores, becoming electronics outlets. The names were thusly changed to Circuit City, and 6 new Circuit City stores were opened in Washington, D.C. that same year. They were not even the largest stores, but they did very well. They even had pickup services, which was new at that time. The following year, Wards continued to shift its focus further on Circuit City. They closed their Dixie Hi-Fi mail order business, as well as multiple other stores in Richmond. They also proceeded to open their next loading dock store in 1979, getting a massive $120 million in sales that year alone. The company, of course, was on a fast track to becoming a retail empire. The chain would naturally grow more ambitious with time. In 1981, Wards Co. entered New York when they merged with the Lafayette Radio Electronics Corp., getting 8 new stores. They purchased the new company for a mere $6.6 million. Unfortunately, however, there were some issues with the acquisition, mainly regards to consumer impressions of the new store. It was seen as a bizarre specialty store that catered to people obsessed with hi-fi electronics. They also had to fight against other retailers who knew the market much better and were able to sell at significantly lower prices. New Circuit City and loading dock stores were opened up in their already successful areas. In the year following, Wards decided they would simplify their market by changing all of their loading dock stores to Circuit City stores. They were now fully streamlined. And by this point, they owned over 100 different retail locations. Now, it was clear that the identity of Wards Co. had changed very dramatically by 1984. It was then decided that they would change the corporate name to Circuit City Stores Inc., meaning Wards was no more. More Circuit City superstores were opened up with time, some as large as an acre of retail space. Lots of very deliberately done advertising elements populated these stores, including walls of television that each displayed the same screen. Another thing was how the stores were set up. Upon entering to a superstore, customers would walk directly past the service section, showing them directly that services were provided on the items they sold. The aesthetic of each store was also calibrated to match consumers' attention. Red tile walkways led consumers through the stores, with the most popular items being at the back of each store to get them to buy more on their way there. By 1984, Circuit City became the big name in technological retail, running a massive 113 stores. Every time a new electronic product was invented or released to the market, like cordless phones and microwave ovens, Circuit City would grow even bigger. While Circuit City superstores were doing well, their New York department was struggling. As a means of continuing their profits, Circuit City would expand into the South. In 1984, they would open up new stores in Atlanta and Florida, a massive and aggressive entry into this new market. They followed a business model I've seen in other stores in the past do, in which they would open up clusters of new locations instead of spreading them out far and wide. This would aid the process of promoting the individual locations, however, this would end up hurting them in the future. Following this move, Circuit City was focused on maximizing profit big time. They closed down all 15 stores from their failed entry into New York and withdrew from their Zodi's department store license. Their efforts in streamlining eventually paid off when in 1987, Circuit City would surpass $1 billion in yearly sales. In 1988, the company would open up their new plug format stores, the iconic design you see today. They tried to capitalize on their new model, and in 1998, they would create the new TV mascot called Pluggy. A short while after their new store model, Circuit City would re-enter New York, this time more properly. Now, of course, it seems like Circuit City is really in the clear, but every good thing will eventually come to an end. Circuit City really began to hit this wall once it entered the early 2000s, when they began to face more problems than they did success. By the time the year 2000 rolled around, Circuit City was doing quite well financially. They were making massive sales margins every year. They had new locations popping up around the country. However, there were problems nonetheless. The first one arises from their stores, which were clearly outdated and lacking renovations. They came off as more old and unattended to than anything. Furthermore, areas change with time. And so by the time the year 2000 rolled around, Circuit City found themselves operating stores in rather bad locations versus their newer, stronger competition, mainly Best Buy. They decided to begin slowly abandoning their large appliance businesses and work on a self-serve format, a new chain of stores called Horizon. This, of course, was a bizarre decision, as only a year ago, Circuit City was America's second largest appliance retailer, right after Sears. However, Lowe's and Home Depot were on the horizon, getting bigger by the day, and so as sort of a preliminary caution, Circuit City would exit the appliances market. This unfortunately hurt them future awards more than it did help them, as chances are, had they awaited the residential boom of the latter 2000s, they could have stayed in business. Horizon stores were noticeably different than anything else. They lacked showrooms, had open floor plans, low ceilings, and shorter aisles. They had old products on the sales floor, and all the cash registers were lined up near the front of the store. The new stores were looking very similar to Best Buy's locations. Around the same era, Circuit City would spend some $1.5 billion retrofitting their old supercenters to have self-serve sections and new product categories. They had more space now to sell wider varieties of products since they had left behind the large appliances market. Then, in 2003, the company would lay off some 3,900 salespeople and switch to a new model of single hourly pays versus sales commissions. This alone saved them $130 million a year. That same year, they would partner up with Verizon Wireless to enter the then-growing phone market. This blocked them from selling phones from any other carrier.
There's a new wave. It's changing the way people find and enjoy the latest technology.
In 2004, Circuit City would purchase Canadian retailer Intertan, getting a massive 980 store locations in Canada. This was done deliberately out of competition with Best Buy, and so these new stores were named The Source in 2005. Yet again, Circuit City would be back to experimenting with store formats. In 2007, they opened a new one called The City. This was characterized by a smaller store of around 20,000 square feet. Moving past 2007, most new stores were The City stores. The company began to struggle yet again. In early 2007, Circuit City would lose 7 superstores in the US, alongside a distribution center in Kentucky, to save costs. 62 locations in Canada were also set to close that same year. Things just got worse from there. In 2007, employee wages were dropped from $8.75 an hour to $7.40 an hour, and they had to begin restaffing based on their lower salaries. However, the lost staff, lower wages, new employees had, strangely enough, the opposite effect the company was expecting, and instead slowed down their sales, big time. Then, something strange happened in 2008 when Blockbuster tried to purchase Circuit City. 2 months later, however, this bid was withdrawn as that company was already struggling enough at this point. Finally, it seemed that the legacy of one of America's largest tech retailers in history would come to an end. In November of 2008, 155 stores were closed down, and it was announced that 17% of their workforce would be gone by December. Somewhere between 500 and 800 employees were laid off from their corporate headquarters in Virginia, and the 1,000 that remained were moved to one unified location to try and lower costs. Then, only 6 days after this announcement, Circuit City would file for Chapter 11 bankruptcy protection. It was the largest liquidation in US history. But it wasn't the end just yet. In fact, it was far from over for the company. Chief executive James Markham announced that the company's stores would stay open, with them getting some $1.1 billion from the court to refinance their operations alongside their already massive assets. Then in 2008, the owner of TV Azteca, a popular Mexican television program, would buy 28% of the company. Could Circuit City be making its return? Well, no, not really, actually. In 2009, Circuit City failed to find a bidder for the company and began liquidation. They sold all their Canadian stores to Bell Canada, and that same year, they began massive liquidations. The very last day of Circuit City's operation was on March 8 of 2009, when Circuit City would finish their liquidation. The company was now officially gone. Wait, no, not yet, actually. That same year in April, Systemax Inc. would purchase all of the bankrupt organization's intellectual property and assets for $6.5 million. Then, in May, the store was revitalized as a digital retailer called CircuitCity.com. This new website was made to look like the original, although it worked more so like Systemax's other websites like CompUSA and TigerDirect. In 2012, the store was merged with TigerDirect, but in 2016, the intellectual assets were bought yet again, and plans were made to revitalize the physical store itself. However, as things stand, the company is, and most likely, will always stay an online retailer. Circuit City's story is a very strange one. What started as a local television store in the 50s would go on to become one of the largest retailers in American history. Circuit City was massive, and at one point had 540 individual stores in the US alone. It seemed like nothing could stop it, and yet something did. I think that alongside competition, Circuit City seemed to just fall behind in the public's eye. I think what killed Circuit City was a matter of time. Because they really could have, and at one point were, competing directly with Best Buy. However, time seemed to catch up with them, and they clearly could not handle the shift that came with it. The shift in American culture, consumer interests, and the general wants and needs of the population. Circuit City stores were behind, they lacked renovations, and they had so many different offshoots that streamlining at some point hurt them more than it helped them. I mean, how much can one company really limit their outreach? At some point, it was bound to catch up with them, and it inevitably did. Their story is weirdly similar to that of Blockbuster, and I think one of the parallels between the two is the fact that both of them were these sort of very specifically hi-fi electric products stores. And unfortunately, those kinds of stores just sort of fell out of the eye of the American public in the modern day. You go into any Best Buy, they sell a wide variety of products. Stores like Circuit City and RadioShack just could not do that. By the end of it, it became one huge mess of failure after failure, until the store would finally manifest into a digital retail outlet, much like the Montgomery Ward store chain. In fact, there are a lot of parallels between these two as well. It seems to me that all of these companies, no matter how different their background is, or the different things they sell, seem to have the same fate.